Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of TERI, I welcome you to the International Workshop on Land Pooling Policy, Paradigm for Sustainable Development. With this, I request Dr. Mathur, Director General TERI, to welcome our esteemed guests and deliver the welcome address.
Professor Bina Agarwal, Mr. Ashok Dalwai, my colleague, Dr. Preeti Jain Das, and colleagues. First of all, welcome on this, what seems to be the first day of winter, although theoretically winter started many days ago. But Delhi in winter is always pleasant, and I'm hoping that air pollution problems will minimize and we will have the joy of having the sun shine on the many square kilometers of Delhi. But I think it is important, what are these square kilometers going to be like? And clearly, we see that as we look to the future, we do see how the city grows, what are the mechanisms by which it grows. When I look at Delhi and I look at the Delhi that I first moved to about, I don't know, 30, 40 years ago, to a very large extent, not completely, but to a very large extent, the vast amounts of populations lived within the outer ring road. Since then, we have had Vasant Kunj, we have had Gurgaon, Noida, Dwarka, and you know, I once counted there are about 8 cities who together account for a population which is more than what Delhi had in the mid 1980s. This is a particular form of urban development that we are seeing across all towns. So metros are growing, and they're growing by new agglomerations coming up. This obviously presents both a challenge, of course, but I also look at it as an opportunity. Because how a city grows, we do have a huge amount of challenges as well as possibilities for experimentation. We all, I think, in this room would agree that the old Land Acquisition Act, the 1894 Act, was, to put it mildly, contentious. It created a property right or a property destroying right, which does not make sense for any civilized, any democratic society. Led to displacement of millions of people without adequately looking at what could be done. I was deeply involved in the kinds of displacement that occurred with hydro projects, but I think it is true of no matter what area that we look at. In 2013, when we passed the RFCTLRR, the right to fair compensation and transparency in land acquisition, when we passed that act, we hoped that we had got over many of the issues that addressed, that were contentious with the old act. In particular, the fact the social impact assessments are done in as much as compensation is fair, in as much as there's a stakeholder involvement that occurs. Nevertheless, while the act has been in place, we have had challenges in making sure that it is implemented in both the spirit and the letter with which it is inked. Consequently, I look at it as a continuing journey, as a journey in progress in which each one of us, the various stakeholders involved, need to put our heads together, need to put our challenges together in order to come up with both, on the one hand, workable and on the other hand, fair and transparent processes. One of the key things about this act, I believe, is the fact that it allows for the adoption of alternate methods of land aggregation. And land pooling is one of them. We have started looking at land pooling in Delhi and in other areas. And it is regarded, I mean, the reason why it is on paper is because it's regarded as a win-win arrangement, where landowners, instead of receiving a one-time compensation for the land, get a portion of the land, and the prices would have increased because of the public infrastructure that has come up there. And since the value of the land that they have, that is returned to them, undergoes appreciation, it is seen as something in which you can create public infrastructure while also enhancing the value of the land. We need to see that this happens. What are the kinds of processes through which we can enable this goal to be achieved? So this two-day event is largely around the challenges faced by land acquiring bodies, particularly state governments and union territories, in implementing the act on the one side, and on the other side, to also look at the kind of process which allows us to ensure that people, particularly those whose land is coming in, particularly those who live on that land, who may not have property rights on the land, but enjoy the usufruct of the land, are also properly brought into the picture. I mean, obviously, compensation is one part, but I think the larger part is that they are part of the deliberative process. So over the next 2 days, I hope that we would address issues related to the contemporary land pooling mechanisms, which are adopted by various development authorities, and in the process identify the kinds of principles that make sense for us to go ahead. I also believe that, the good cannot be the enemy of the best. And consequently, what we need to do is, where do we want to move in the longer term, and what are the kinds of building blocks that we adopt now so that it helps us move towards our ultimate goal. I again welcome all of you here and look forward to 2 days of deliberations at this meeting. Thank you so much.
Before I call on our next speaker, may I please request the room to switch their phones off or on silent mode, please? Thank you, Dr. Mathur. And I now invite Dr. Bina Agarwal to deliver the inaugural address. Professor Agarwal is currently teaching development, economics, and environment at the Global Development Institute, University of Manchester. She has also served in an advisory capacity in several UN institutions and contributed for many years to India's planning process. Among the many accolades she has amassed are a Padma Shri in 2008 and the Leontief Prize in 2010. We are happy to have you, Professor.
Thank you, Dr. Mathur, Dr. Ashok Dalwai, Dr. Preeti Das, and distinguished guests. I thank TERI for inviting me to speak on a topic which is so close to my heart. And I welcome the new angle from which the issue of land is being approached at this conference, at least by the title, Land Pooling for Sustainable Development. I take the title very seriously. Now, there are many aspects to modern India's concern with the question of land, because it is not only the most valuable productive resource, but it also remains the most important form of property. People do generations of litigation just to keep track of a small piece of ancestral property, even though the economic value would not justify it. So I think land is not just an economic issue, it's also a very strong emotive issue and an issue of citizenship. We must remember that when we are talking about implementing any kind of law on it. Now, land has also, we know, been at the center of the growing clamor by economists for structural reform to revive the economy. I mean, land and labor are the two issues which are seen as structural issues. And the main emphasis, of course, has been on land acquisition for industry. But all of us who deal with land, including most of you, or all of you here, is that land is that we know that land is one of the most complex questions today because it has multiple uses and it has myriad claimants. So very broadly, we need land for what purposes? Agriculture and rural habitation, industry and infrastructure, urban development, and cities. But increasingly, the language we hear is the language of government land acquisition, as is also clear from the focus on compensation and rehabilitation. And we hear almost nothing about land in the service of people and livelihoods. So in my remarks today, I will focus on the issue of land pooling, but from a very different perspective from the concern simply of industry and infrastructure and urban development. I will focus on the perspective of land use for agriculture and sustainable welfare in rural areas where a large part of the land is located, as is a large part of India's population. Now, I believe we need rural land pooling for achieving the larger goal of sustainable development and sustainable livelihoods. So I will talk about three aspects. I will argue that we need voluntary land pooling by farmers for viable cultivation. Indeed, this could be transformative for Indian agriculture. Secondly, we need land pooling for servicing the land, but not just for building roads or buildings. We need servicing in terms of reclaiming the fertility of our soils, reviving our water bodies and water basins, and regenerating our forests. Third, we need to seriously focus on how the gains from land pooling will be shared among those who own little land and who depend on that land for their livelihoods, namely women and landless labor. So let me talk briefly about each of these in turn. Firstly, land pooling for agriculture. Now, we know that Indian agriculture today is in a crisis. We see high levels of landlessness, we see growing inequality, dwindling plot sizes, and fragmented holdings. All of this is against the backdrop of climate change and limited non-farm options. Globally, 84% of all farms across 111 countries are under 2 hectares in size. Believe me, even in Europe, you have very small farms in many cases. And in India, 86% of farmers, 86%, cultivate less than 2 hectares, 70% cultivate 1 hectare or less. The small farmers also face serious constraints in terms of diseconomies of scale, lack of access to inputs, irrigation, credit, technology, and markets. Now, women farmers, who constitute 30% by the latest figures of all farm workers, are even more resource constrained. They own little land, and by my ongoing assessment, although there's very little national level data, is that only about 14% of landowners in India are women, and they own about 11% of land. Yet 73% of rural women workers are still dependent on agriculture. So here is where land pooling for group farming could provide an answer. What do I mean by group farming? I mean farming where small farmers voluntarily pool their land, labor, capital, and skills to create a medium-sized enterprise which they cultivate jointly, sharing costs and benefits, but without forfeiting their rights to their own land. Now, often when I mention group farming, people say, oh, you mean cooperative farming, don't you? You mean cooperatives? The answer is yes and no, because cooperatives mean many things to many people. Cooperation in farming can range from what I call single purpose to fully integrated cooperation. Single purpose cooperation, there are many examples. Basically, they're marketing cooperatives around the dairy industry. And in Europe, they go back hundreds of years. India's Amul industry is an example of a marketing single purpose cooperative. It means that you keep your individual production and you simply come together for marketing. In between, one can talk about medium-level cooperation, for instance, investing jointly in irrigation wells. And you have a tradition of that. If you look at Darling's book on the Punjab in the early part of the 20th century, he talks about farmers coming together for irrigation well investment. But group farming goes much beyond it. It involves collective production on pooled land and intensive labor cooperation on a daily basis. Now, this idea of group farming, of course, is not new. Most of you will say, well, we know about socialist collectivization, and we know it was a disaster in terms of welfare and so on. And you would be right. Then you might say, some of you might say, that, well, India tried group farming or cooperative farming in the 1960s, and those were promoted, we know, top-down as part of agrarian reform. And there are numerous documents of that in the Planning Commission. But these also largely failed. Why? Because they tried to involve, we had no idea how to come bring together people for cooperation. We involved large and small farmers and large numbers of them within a single village without recognizing that there could be conflicting interests. What I'm talking about is none of these. I'm talking about farmers who form groups voluntarily, small in size and relatively homogeneous. Now, conceptually, we could argue that we would expect land pooling and joint cultivation to bring many economic benefits to small farmers. For instance, the most important is it would enlarge farm size and help reap economies of scale. Now, there are assessments for all India. There are two American economists, Andrew Foster and Mark Rosenzweig, who have written extensively on Indian agriculture. And they wrote a paper called, Are Indian Farms Too Small? And they found that farm size in India increased, if it increased from very tiny to up to 8 hectares, it would raise profits per hectare, and especially up to 2 hectares. Also, pooling land and cultivating together would save on hired labor. It would bring a larger pool of funds for inputs. It would tap a wider diversity of skills than found in one person or family. You could experiment more with risk-prone, higher-value crops with larger payoffs. You could spread your losses among a greater number, and you could better deliver on contracts and also have more bargaining power in markets and with the state. Now, group farms can be formed either by leasing land together or pooling the members' own land or a mix of these. But the obvious question to ask, and certainly a question that I as an economist would ask, is how productive and profitable are they? So to test this, I undertook two primary surveys in the states of Kerala and Telangana during 2012 and 14 for a sample of group farms and individual farms. The individual family farms, 95% of them were male managed. The group farms were entirely composed of women. Now, I'll give particularly the example of Kerala, which began its program in the 2000s. And the initial idea of group farming actually came from village women who had experimented with leasing land in groups because there was fallow land lying. But the larger program was crafted by senior government officials and by intellectuals. Now, it was structured around a self-help group model, and it has been supported by the state government's poverty eradication mission, the Kudum Shree mission, as well as the Kudum Shree community network. Now, these are community development societies which are autonomous from the village level to the panchayat level. Now, Kerala's group farms are small. Each group is small. Six members, they lease in land, and it's mostly on a cash rent basis. They receive subsidized credit through NABARD. We know that all India, NABARD gives subsidized credit to groups. And they also receive a startup grant, some technical information and training from experts, and crop-specific incentives. Can you guess how many such group farms there are in Kerala, Dr. Mathur? 64,000. Not one or two. They cover every district, and they cover 3 lakh women. So to test the differences in productivity and profits between group and individual farms, I compared 69 group farms with 181 small family farms of 2 hectares or less in two districts, Alappuzha and Thrissur. Alappuzha was a paddy growing area, and Thrissur was much more commercial, and I thought it'd be interesting to take those two. And what I collected was not monthly data or one time. Weekly data for every input and output, for every plot and every crop and every type of input for an entire year, 12 to 13 months, which is a huge data set, as you can imagine. What did I find? I found that the annual average value of output was 1.8 times greater, and the annual average profits were 5 times higher on group farms than individual family farms. They did especially well on commercial crops such as bananas and vegetables, despite depending on leased land. The per farm income was much higher than the state average for the years that I did the study. What did the groups do? They helped increase farm size, they brought scale economies, they saved on hired labor, input, and they saved on input purchase, they improved access to credit, and they could enter into deliverable contracts. I also studied Telangana. Here the groups did well in commercial cotton, but they didn't do as well in food crops because they could not get irrigated leased land. And there are some lessons there. What is interesting is that partly, because I've been writing on this for several years and publishing, is that influenced by my writings, new examples have emerged with NGO support in Gujarat as well as North Bengal and Bihar. Now in East India, we find that you have groups which are all male groups, mixed gender groups, and all women groups. And you have youth groups. Now this is very interesting because some of the youths who used to migrate to cities have stopped doing so. They use drip irrigation for vegetable farming and make profits. So land pooling also, one can imagine, and group farming can reduce farmer isolation and hence the likelihood of suicides. So the kind of land pooling I'm talking about could create sustainable livelihoods, and it could be a means of alleviating India's agrarian crisis. I've written about this, I've talked about it. It's in the 12th five-year plan, although not to the Niti Aayog so far. But we need to move beyond, you know, other than Kerala, there are no large-scale examples. The second issue of land pooling, I feel, is important, is for saving our natural resources, our soils, our waters, our forests. It's supposed to, what is land pooling supposed to do? If you read the text, it says to help service the land for the owners and to increase its value. That's the way it's being sold, service the land. But in rural areas, the servicing we desperately need is reviving our soils and water bodies. Servicing is not just about building roads and infrastructure and then the value of the land rises. Most of our soils are depleted of minerals, of micronutrients, because of overcropping, because of chemical fertilizers, and so on. And large areas are waterlogged. We also have serious water problems. All of you know that. You know, look at today's, I think, what is it, Indian Express, where you have the chief minister talking about how do we move from paddy to maize. On the one hand, therefore, even 70 years after independence, only 44% of our irrigable area is irrigated. On the other hand, we have massive groundwater depletion due to excessive borewell use. Now, this is unsustainable. Punjab's water table is falling at 2.3 feet per year for at least a decade. So we need more irrigation for raising farm outputs on the one hand, but we need that irrigation without groundwater mining. We need alternative irrigation systems, a basket of alternatives, including rainwater harvesting. Now, this cannot be done by individual farmers on small plots. It needs land pooling to work on an entire water basin. And this would be the kind of servicing that could be done via land pooling. Then take climate change. Now, for climate change, we know that the climate doesn't stop on the boundaries of Delhi or on the boundaries of Punjab. You have entire regions. It should be ecological zones that we talk about. So to plan for cropping patterns which are sustainable and suitable for the land and the water resources, we require land pooling and crop planning across ecological zones. So I know we talked about this about 15 years ago, but somehow it never moved forward. So basically, what I'm talking about is diametrically opposite to the ongoing debate on land pooling, which is about government land acquisition for infrastructure, urban development, and industries, with farmers facilitating the acquisition through land pooling. So farmers are simply instrumental in this. I'm not saying that land for industry and infrastructure is not important. Of course, it's very important. But we should not limit the discussion only to that kind of land pooling, since that is only one use of land. And finally, my last point, that in relation to land pooling for land acquisition, we need to consider some issues vis-a-vis the 2013 Land Acquisition Act. Well, just to make it shorter, rather than saying RFCTLARR. it should have been an acronym, but it isn't a proper acronym. Now, this act promises transparent acquisition with farmer consent and fair compensation. All this sounds very good on paper, but implementing this raises some significant questions, especially for women and the landless. So first, let me ask, whose land is being pooled? After the amendment of the Hindu Succession Act of 2005, daughters have rights in family land as co-partners. But are those rights recognized when we discuss land pooling with a farmer? We need a mechanism to ensure that all family members who have a claim to the family land are consulted and have given their consent to pool their land. So we talk about consent, but whose consent are we talking about? Secondly, although formally very few women have pattas in their own right, a large percent depend on land for livelihoods. And this is especially true of rural India. I gave you the latest figures, which is 73% of women in rural India still depend on farming for a livelihood. So women working on family farms or as agricultural labor are much more dependent on it than men in rural India, and because they have fewer non-farm options. Now, this has implications for compensation. Technically, the 2013 Act recognizes the rights of those who are dependent on the land for a livelihood, even if they don't own it. But it's easier said than done. How do you actually prove your claims? How do we ensure that all household adults, including adult daughters who are now recognized, they're above the age of 18, if they're dependent on the land in farming families, how will they be recognized in compensation? Third, the form of compensation matters. So we talk about cash compensation, but can, as we know, I mean, just as with cash transfers, the cash can be spent by men even if it goes into the joint account of both spouses. So compensation in the form of land and resettlement housing is much more likely to provide families protection. Remember, it's not just about women, it's about entire families. And again, joint titles, or by joint, I don't mean just the spouses, which is now becoming common, but also everybody who has a right in the land and homes is essential. Fourth, if part of the pooled land is returned to the family, according to the Act, once it has been serviced, in whose name will it be registered? Will it have the names of all the claimants, male and female? So I know some states have been implementing this. What is the experience of the states? Have they taken this into account? Many of you here. Then compensating those who are landless agricultural workers is actually even more difficult because we don't have formal contracts. And to prove their dependence on the land for a livelihood. Today, even if you're farming leased in land, you can't prove you're a farmer because you don't have a formal contract. So I think all these things that we put on paper, surely we need to put on paper mechanisms by which they can actually be implemented, if at all. And again, we need to know the experience of states. So I'll conclude by the three points I've made. First, instrumental land pooling just to help the government acquire land for some vaguely defined social purpose is not an answer and will only cause conflicts. We need to consider all aspects of land pooling, including for agriculture itself. Second, in my view, the most important potential of land pooling lies in two aspects. Firstly, voluntary bottom-up pooling of land by small farmers for group farming to help them raise productivity. And second, land pooling to improve soil quality for water conservation and ecological crop planning to revive our land and deal better with climatic crisis. And finally, where land pooling is attempted for industry and infrastructure development, we need to ensure that those who are dependent on land but don't have titles, like women in particular, are equal partners both to decisions and to compensation, be it compensation in cash or compensation in the form of land and housing. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. I think you bring out some really pertinent points, especially given the feminization of farm laborer and the landlessness that we're facing right now. I now request Dr. Ashok Dalwai to deliver his keynote address. Dr. Dalwai is the CEO, National Rainfed Area Authority under Ministry of Agriculture and Farmer Welfare, Government of India. He was a chairman of Interministerial Committee on Doubling Farmers' Income and has now been tasked to supervise DFI implementation as chairman of the empowered body.
Dr. Mathur, Dr. Bina Agarwal, Dr. Preeti Das, Dr. Madam Chaudhary, the former secretary, and all the participants in this two-day workshop. Good morning to all of you. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Dr. Bina has, in fact, delivered the keynote speech. And to that extent, makes my job easier, or rather, she enables me to tide over this difficult challenge of talking about sustainability, land use planning, and pooling, etc. I will hold myself back from talking too much about agriculture. In a way, that is a natural inclination for people like me and Arvind sitting here, having studied agriculture, dealing with agriculture, although it's very important. Maybe I'll deal with that through the course of my talk. So what I would now really depend upon is to go back to my own experience of having handled land at the district level, having worked in various departments like industries, steel and mines, and handled land acquisition, having served as the commissioner of Bangalore City and dealt with land. We have Manjunath, my next successor here. Or having served as director of resettlement, or having worked in the revenue department with land settlement. So let me try to gather all those very desperate and sporadic thoughts that I have in my mind into some coherence here. What we really first need to understand is that land use planning is extremely important. But the sad part that all of us must apply ourselves to is that we are the inheritors of one of the oldest civilizations, Indus Valley Civilization. And the core spirit of Indus Valley Civilization was urban management, land management. I really wonder, where did we lose all that skill, all that knowledge, all that commitment that we had 5,000 years ago? Today, I think India is one of the sad stories of land management. It's also sad that we have been talking about land measurement, land pooling, etc., at least since the 16th centuries. I think more scientific land management, including land measurement, began during the times of Bir Balakpur. Somewhere in the last 400 years, we seem to have lost sight of it. We now need to apply ourselves more seriously to this aspect. The reason is land is inelastic. Land is limited in the Indian context. India is a very vast country, we keep saying. It is seventh largest in terms of its geography. But it is scarce because we have too much of population. India hosts near highest, I say, because we are about to beat China soon. But we are only we are so small compared to China in terms of area, or so small compared to Russia. So land is a scarce commodity. When there are alternate demands for a scarce resource, what it calls for is scientific approach to using that scarce resource. About 329 million hectares of land we have. Today, it is split among different components. Majorly, agriculture uses it at 46%. That means 141 million hectares, or 329, is under agriculture. Forest is the next important one. Glad that we had that Forest Conservation Act in 1980. And we have been able to sacredly maintain that 22% of the area under forests. And we have the rest of it, which has been either put to use already, or there is something called culturable wasteland, non-culturable wasteland, barren lands, and that accounts for about 30%. Of this 30%, we already have used nearly 26 million hectares, accounting for about 8.6%, for different uses. That includes habitations. There are about 7 lakh villages in this country. There are about 500 towns in this country. Then we have 5,000 towns, sorry, around 300 large agglomerations. We also have industry, mining sector, infrastructure, roads, ports, and so on and so forth. All these things have already come to use 26 million hectares. So this being the story, we now need to see how the future demands can be met. The future demands are going to emerge from the need to grow faster for India. India is still a developing country. India has a population which is still below poverty line. India is a country where still there is malnourishment. India is a country where still people are without houses and homes. And there are many things that we need to still do and see the purchasing power of all the people in this country rises. Not just rise of purchasing power, but equitability, because that alone can ensure sustainability. Many a time we talk of sustainability in terms of ecology. Yes, ecological sustainability is foundational for ensuring the economic sustainability or the social sustainability. So equitability, which is one of the foundations of our constitution, is extremely important. So if India has to meet all these things, we need to build better roads, better infrastructure. We need to promote industries. We need to ensure that the living standards of the people are comparable to a dignified human existence. We also need to ensure that the organic life, the life of the animals, the plant world, the microorganisms, and other natural resources, all these things are harmonized. When we think of these different inorganic and organic forms of life, there will be contradictory demands from all these things. So if we are talking about a land use planning on a sustainable basis, we must ensure that these competing demands from different sources, which are also conflicting in nature, are reconciled. So I think that's where the real challenge lies in land use planning. If we would like to ensure that land use planning happens while simultaneously meeting the demands of a growing economy or the economy that should grow, then we will have to ensure that the land required for all these things is properly allocated. Today, our cities, for example, yes, urbanization is happening. It is more an unplanned growth, a haphazard growth. When unplanned and haphazard growth happens, naturally, the land is not used properly. We need to face new challenges. It is therefore important that right from the word go, we focus on proper land utilization, whether it is for habitation or economic sectors or for social environment. So the three basic things that we must keep in mind as we plan for proper use of our limited land is, first is, how do I allocate the land required for the economic development? When we say economic development, I must reiterate that in Indian context, agriculture occupies a primacy. And the second one is, of course, the industry, manufacturing, and service sectors. Agriculture occupies a primacy for the simple reason that even today, 48% of this elephantine-sized population of India continues to depend on it, directly or indirectly. And the scope for shifting all this population to the new economic activities may not be very much, because today in the 21st century and the centuries to come, we'll be depending more and more on emerging technologies which will replace the manpower. So the scope that the Western societies had in the 19th century or in the 20th century, where they could shift out people from agriculture to industry, or they could migrate their populations to new areas like Australia and USA, does not exist anymore for India. If that is the case, we must ensure that the primary economic activity of agriculture is practiced and protected for sustainable growth and development. And of course, the manufacturing sector. But the second important thing is, we should also take care of our social environment. Because economics and sociology sometimes seem contradictory. And that's how the Land Acquisition Act of 1894 believed so. Because for it, land to be acquired for any economic sector, which was just defined as a public purpose, and it was the collector who defined it as a public purpose. Maybe he didn't understand what the public purpose was with the limited understanding at that particular age. So what happens is that we need to ensure that the social issues that relate to the tribal communities, that relate to the deprived sections of the society, that relate to the rural population, the farmers, the uneducated, the women. And apart from this, the social issues also mean that we respect the religious and cultural traditions of our country. There are heritage sites. There are places that are considered sacred. Now, all these things are uncompromisable. So as we now resort to land acquisition or land pooling, we must also respect the social dimensions of our land management. And the third, of course, very important is environmental. Because ecology is something, because we India, mankind has not looked at ecology as an important aspect of a development story, we have the catastrophe called climate change. It's not that climate change has not happened to history. Climate change has happened every time. If there was no climate change, we would not have had life on this earth. But today's climate change is man-induced. Within a span of a limited 200 years, since the industrialization began, we have contributed so much of greenhouse gases and brought about this climate change that the implications are very adverse, particularly for tropical countries like India, where the rise in temperature can cause depletion of yields within next 10, 20, or 30 years. Whereas temperate climates like Canada or USA may stand to benefit from climate change because they want a rise in temperature in the cold climates. So there could be different implications for climate change for different people. But for India, environment has to be ensured. When we talk of environment, what we mean is to see that we protect our fragile zones. In the coastal belts, for example, there are conservation hotspots, there are biodiversity hotspots, and there are water bodies and soil, and of course atmosphere. And all these resources, which are natural, they are organically linked. If we do not take care of the soil, it will result in the loss of microorganisms. For example, India is home to 86,000 species of fauna. That means animals. India is one of the richest diversity on the earth in terms of animal species. But of these 86,000, majority belong to the microorganisms. And those microorganisms are in the soil. Today, thanks to improper and unscientific land management or soil management over the last 50 years, we have lost a lot of microorganisms. And we don't know what kind of depletion, what kind of deleterious impact it is having on the productivity of the land. And likewise, we also need to take care of the floral world. India is also very rich in terms and stands at about 46,000 species of different plant species. And diversity of this flora is basic to developing resistance to the changing climate, developing resistance to the abiotic pressures. We need varieties, new plant breeding techniques. All these things can happen provided we enrich and will sustain our enriched biodiversity. So environmental management in land use planning is very important. So there are three basic things that any management which deals with land management or land pooling must keep this in mind. The next issue is, how good is India in land planning? Does India, I started off saying that we are the inheritors of Indus Valley civilization, which is supposed to have done urban planning at Harappa and Mohenjo-daro, but somewhere on the road to our journey, we lost it out today. Today, India lacks or does not yet have, so sorry, such a sad state that we don't have an integrated, comprehensive land use planning system. Yes, there are land use planning in urban areas. Every city has a development authority. Or even gram panchayats are supposed to be having some kind of a regulatory power under the 73rd Amendment. Yes, we have this kind of planning for industries, for example, or for mining sector. But these are all so disaggregated that there is no organic linkage. We seem to think that each of these requirements for mining or for industry or for habitation building, they are all compartmentalized, as though they're islands. Now, when we approach land management with this particular isolated, compartmentalized prism of my mindset, we are bound to fail, and that's what is happening in India. Why it happens? Now you can go, you can see, for example, if there is an ecologically fragile zone, then the urban development will come up, or the national highway will come up and say, I want to build a road, I need to build a tramway. Now, what does it manifest? It only manifests that each does not know what the other wants, or each does not think what the organic linkage means. What does land pooling, or not land management for a country like India size mean? So what we need today is to have a comprehensive, integrated land use planning system for our country, which applies to the entire country with necessary changes at the state and regional level for that matter. However, this comprehensive plan must appreciate that each impacts the other, because there are conflicting demands and there will be conflicting outcomes of the use of this land. We can have, for example, a zoo, we can have a reserved zone, but what happens to the buffer zone around that? Can we start building high-rise, for example, around a fragile ecological zone? Can you build some high-rise flat on just on the bank of the coastal belt or by the side of the river? This is all something that is damaging our land. What we therefore now need to do is to bring people together who understand the subject, who understand what is land and land management, and build a robust science-based land use planning system. And India has that capacity. We only just need to capacitate further. For example, we are extremely strong in the applications of space technology. We have a national remote sensing agency. So we can build spatial maps which will enable us to understand better at one go as to what the land looks like and how it should look. We have people who have been trained in town planning. We have people who have been trained in land management in the revenue departments. Unfortunately, all these people do not come together. So what we now need to do as we build this comprehensive plan is to first adopt robust policies for the countries. I think there is a wide gap in the policies itself. So we now need to look at what kind of policies do we have, how compartmentalized they are, how they can be harmonized into comprehensive one plan. So policy building is the first step that we should look at. The second one, of course, is to capacitate people, that is, build the capacities of people to do land management, town planning, industrial investment zone planning, coastal regulation planning, fragile eco zone planning. All kinds of these specialized understanding is required among the professionals, but they all need to work together. And the third thing is to build institutions. We don't have institutions. I've seen, and Manjunath would agree with me, that we work, as say, one is working as a commissioner of a city corporation, there's another working as a commissioner of a development authority. The two don't talk to each other. And there's a third one who is a commissioner of the regional planning authority. That man, his existence itself is not known. This happens in all cities, whether it's Delhi or in Mumbai or Hyderabad or Bangalore, anywhere. These three people are so crowded with their own work that they don't talk to each other and they forget the permanent damage that this kind of haphazard growth is happening. So I think we need to build institutions that will bring about convergence, collaboration, and put people together to put their mind and thought together and see how most efficiently and effectively the scarce land resources is utilized. So we need institutions. And of course, lastly, that we also need to ensure that the people are involved. I think many a time all our policies and plans in this country are not able to deliver the desired or the targeted result only because the people are not involved. So community participation, it cannot be something, a highfalutin idea, which is to be put as a last point, last paragraph, to make our document look nice. No. In fact, I would say that should be the first thing. After all, for whom are we doing these things? All that we do is for people. All that we do is for people's present and future. So I think the land use planning will require the core principle of ensuring the people's participation right at planning stage and also at implementation stage. So these are the four, I think, principles or the pillars of any kind of a comprehensive land use planning that we must look at. Now let me move a little forward. I think we've done enough about this land use planning, as to how do we go about seeing that each of these sectors actually is treated. So I think for land, for example, let's now talk a little about agriculture. I promised that I will talk a little about agriculture. Professor Bina Agarwal has already spoken, but I think, and she has really made very good points, that yes, land management as far as agriculture is concerned, in the last 50 years since the Green Revolution, has been good and bad. It has been good because we have increased our food output. We have ensured that there's food surplus, I mean, sufficiency and surplus. But simultaneously, what has happened is that the growth in agriculture sector, growth of the agri-commodities, has not benefited the farmers. Farmers are the entrepreneurs. Just like we have entrepreneurs in the industrial service sector, farmer is an entrepreneur. But where does the farmer stand today? Farmers' incomes are so low compared even to the industrial labor that his welfare cannot be ensured. The 2012-13 survey by National Sample Survey Office showed us that an average agriculture household in our country earns an average of 6,446 rupees per month. Imagine if somebody joins the government, even at the lowest scale, he starts with rupees 22,000 per month. And here is a farmer who owns land, a very valuable asset, and he was earning 6,426, which has been extrapolated in 2015-16 to mean about 98,000 rupees per year. Now, is this a sustainable, dignified living facilitator? Certainly not. So what we now need to do is, how do we land manage in agriculture such that the farmer is able to earn better? We now therefore need to move from pure productivity and production domain into income domain. We need to integrate all our production with the markets by building strong agriculture value systems. We need to enable the farmer to capture maximum value through robust post-harvest management technologies. According to me, we don't really need 142 million hectares that we have today for agriculture. With the application of science and technology, it is possible for us to achieve such high levels of productivity as per our requirement that we may not need 141 million hectares. It's a different matter, though, that even if we are able to release some surplus land for other activities as required, how do we ensure that the farmers who will continue to depend on agriculture, or the landless agriculture labor will continue to depend upon agriculture, are able to get employment for 365 days. So one of the first mandates that we need to redefine for agriculture in our country from the sustainability perspective is to say that the mandate of agriculture is to generate employment and incomes. Today, the mandate is to generate food for the consumers. Yes, we have done enough for the consumers, but now we need to do for the farmers. Therefore, the first mandate of agriculture has to be generate gainful employment and gainful profits, and that is possible by bringing in new science technology, and more importantly, by bringing in new management practices, which will enable scales of economy that Dr. Bina was talking about. The scales of economy will come when we can pool the lands together. Of course, some baby steps have been taken by us now. For example, we have drafted what's called a Model Contract and Services Farming Act for the state governments. And we hope that the state governments will adopt this new legislation so that the farmers as a community would be able to enter into agreement with some sponsored companies for negotiating the post-harvest market risks. Secondly, we are now aiming at establishing minimum 10,000 farmer producers organizations by 2022. And the experience so far has not been very good, but we have learned a lot from it. And now, based on those learnings, we would like to go forward and see how farmer producers organizations, and more particularly the farmer producers companies that combine the flexibility of a private company under the Companies Act and the spirit of a cooperative under the Cooperative Act are actually blend together for more efficient and sustainable means. And we're also now talking about land pooling through other means. For example, establishing what is called as Grameen Agriculture Markets, which will help aggregation of the lots of the farmers at the retail outlet. Today we have APMCs which are at a distance of 40 to 50 kilometers. Farmers are not able to reach them out. We would like to have aggregation platforms in a proximity of 5 to 6 kilometers from the farm gate so that the farmers' produce gets aggregated. Why is it necessary? It is necessary because today in India, thanks to absence of robust agri-logistics, like storage and transportation, including integrated cold systems, India is experiencing a loss of nearly 20% of the food that is generated. And if you take this food loss, which converts into, by decomposition, into greenhouse gases, it's of a very high order. In fact, the world today is generating so much of greenhouse gas because it doesn't have a green agri-logistics and is generating greenhouse gases. It stands third if it is counted as a country. The first being China, second being USA. The third is this food waste on this earth. Imagine, farmers are producing food to be wasted because we are not providing them good agri-logistics. So I think we need to go more and more for land pooling. So let me end up by talking a little bit about land pooling. Yes, we have had the Land Acquisition Act, which all agreed that it was not really pro-people because it gave an eminent domain power to the states to acquire land in the name of public purpose. And at that point of time, we really did not look at different organic linkages that existed. And we are aware that so much of land is acquired in this country without reference to the fertility status of land, that the people who were dependent on land were left high and dry. They got something called a compensation, but compensation was linked to what is called a land registered value. And land registration in India itself is full of lies, as you know. Both the seller and the purchaser, they register at such a low value, artificially low value, that when we depend upon the registers that a land registrar maintains, then this poor fellow, in the name of market value, was getting peanuts, despite adding a solatium of 30% on that thing. And we all knew that, you know, this was something, it was a false statement, but we paid that. And then this man who did not have literacy, who did not have education, who knew only agriculture, nothing else, and neither was there an opportunity for him to get into any kind of a service sector or industry sector, was actually an affected family. So the project affected people, the project affected families have actually gone into ruins. They have shifted to slums of urban centers. They become landless. Yes. So there have been lots of problems with Land Acquisition Act. Now the land pooling, which has actually started with the urban centers, with the necessary changes, it has to be applied for land pooling for industries, land pooling for infrastructure like roads, land pooling for urban habitations, and everywhere that we need, I think we now need to develop this land pooling mechanism with much more fineness, much more sophistication. And not that this can be done only by the non-government agencies, but ultimately we need some kind of arbitrator because that it also can have people who do not agree with land pooling. So we need an institutional mechanism, the government, which will facilitate this land pooling and address the conflicts, resolve the conflicts, and wherever there is some kind of a dissatisfaction, that is resolved appropriately. So I think it's a good thing that we're taking this step forward. In fact, Germany started in 1880. Imagine we're talking about it after 130 years now. So we will literally seem to be 100 years behind all these European nations in some of these modern progressive thoughts. So it's time that we move away from the colonial hangover, the feudal mindset rather. In fact, India has got a more feudal mindset than colonial mindset. This comes before the pre-British who came to India. We need to break that feudal mindset that I own the land, that government owns the land, that some zamindar owns the land. It's a people's land. So I think we need to think from the people's perspective and see how we enable him to change one occupation to another as we acquire his land for any purpose, public purpose, and ultimately ensure sustainability. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Dalwai. We'll be opening the floor for questions. I request Dr. Mathur to moderate the questions, please.
Thank you. We have had two excellent presentations from Professor Agarwal and Dr. Dalwai. And what we'll do is open up the floor for some questions. If you can let me know if there are questions, just raise your hand so that I get an idea of the time and how we will allocate it. Okay, what we will do is we'll start with two questions. I'll request Dr. Dalwai and Professor Agarwal to answer them, and then we will go in for another round. Sir? Yeah, if you could introduce yourself as well.
Hello. Good evening. Good morning. I'm Nilanjali, Deputy Director, AMDA. My question is that does this FRA anywhere falls in the realm of land pooling policy? Because we keep talking about farmers. Aren't we concerned about forest dwellers?
Okay. We'll take the other question as well. Yes, right here in front.
Okay. My name is Arvind Padi. I come from Ekrisad. Madam Bina Agarwal spoke about land pooling for agriculture. But to my conscientious mind, we should go to legalize land leasing first before
we should legalize what land?
Land leasing.
Okay.
Land leasing. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. We'll take one more and then come back and then we'll take another round. Yeah. Please go ahead.
I am Naneshwar Patil, Secretary of Revenue, Madhya Pradesh. I want to ask just one question to Dr. Bina Agarwal. She wants this co-partners and joint accountability in titles, all including all heirs in this title. But one-sided, we are thinking on the title registration, because we know that the deed registration has a lot of problems, lot of other stakeholders and other officers who are delaying the process of mutation and partition. And the other side, we are insisting that we include all the names and everything. It is very, the different departments are thinking different way. Just, I want to clarify.
Okay. We'll come back. Okay. Is there just one more question or are there more? Okay. Why don't you ask as well? And then I think we can.
I'm Madhusudan. My question is to Dr. Bina Agarwal. She was talking of grouping policy of the farmers. Is it on lines with the self-help groups that we're talking of, which is already existing in the villages?
Okay.
The self-help groups.
The self-help group, do they already exist, or is it something we created? So we'll take these four questions, and I turn to Professor Agarwal and Dr. Dalwai to provide responses. Please.
Thank you for those questions. And I had also a small comment for Dr. Dalwai, which I'll add at the end. you know, I won't go into the FRA. Maybe I'll leave it to you because that's another whole conversation. Firstly, the ICRISAT question. You see, land leasing has always been a reality from the time of independence. The Land Reform Acts of every single state, which I know like the back of my hand, by the way, were then put into the Constitution in a schedule where you couldn't even challenge them on any count. So, in Kerala, for instance, where the example I gave, where the 64,000 land lease groups of women alone, it's banned technically, but. We also know that land leasing is a ground reality. So the problem with dealing with land leasing is that is the original acts. So for instance, the moment you create formal rights of the tenant, the farmer fears that they will lose the right to the land. Mm-hmm. Because if you're not land to the tiller was really our policy in the 1950s. And we have to therefore do it in tandem with those acts, which we are not talking about. So I know that the Niti Aayog has got a tenancy act, and I don't think it's been passed yet. But Ramesh Chand did send it to me. However, unless we also deal with the land reform acts, which are in the constitution, and that can be done state-wise because those acts are under the as a state subject, we are not going to move from there. Because people are not going to. Now, if you take France, for instance, I'm also doing research on France on group farming, and you find that people have formal leases and they're 9-year leases, they're renewable, nobody loses the original plot of land unless they want to sell it. And there's an authority called SAFAR, which actually negotiates. Mm-hmm. So if Dr. Mathur owns 20 hectares, and he wishes he did, but let's assume he does. And then he says, I know Professor Bina Agarwal, she's a really good organic farmer, and I'd like to lease to her. But the SAFAR will say, but no, Dr. Preeti Das is a younger farmer, and you can't just lease to Professor Bina Agarwal because she's a friend of yours. You must give it. So what I'm saying is there is an authority which actually negotiates how land is used, for good purpose, even among farmers. But at the same time, the leasing issue isn't an issue because you don't lose your land simply because you're land leasing. So you're quite right, we need to work on the question of land leasing, but in a much more complex way than the way we've been approaching it. that should not stop us from group farming, because farmers are leasing in anyway, and 64,000 groups is not to be laughed at, mm-hmm. Especially if some of these groups are producing 1.8 times the annual value of output than individual family farms. The second is that, by the way, ICRISAT data needs to be, something needs to be done about some aspects of the data, which I have some views on, which I will share with you over tea. The question that you've raised, Madhya Pradesh Secretary Revenue on co-partners, you see, that's precisely the point, that people have rights, and those rights have to be recorded. It may be, life is complicated. You know, people have rights and they have 5 cents of land. 5 cents of land means a great deal if it's irrigated. As I'm sure Dr. Dalwai will say, he works on rain-fed, but actually if it's irrigated, 5 cents of land can be an important plot of land. So you cannot get away from the need to actually record all the shares. And is it the revenue department which is not wanting to do it, or which your department doesn't want to put in the names of all theirs? Is it, or?
Excuse me. There are two types of registration, deed registration and title registration. Mm-hmm. Government of India also insisting title registration, their mandate is there. Because there's a lot of problem in mutation, in deed registration. Lot of inquiries are there. Even we don't know, that during registration, the land is immediately transferred to my name or not. So title registration is clear title.
You see, you have, one has to recognize what the Hindu Succession Act, the Inheritance Act does. So there are two types of property. There's separate property and there's joint family property. Yes. Now, joint family property, people can be co-partners without partition. The government can't insist that you have to partition in order to just to record the deed digitally. You cannot partition on behalf of people. If I have a family, if these four people are my family, you can't come in and say, no, you must pretend as if they have been partitioned, because that has very major repercussions, as you know. So I think you have to record them as joint owners. Just as when government gives land to spouses these days, when you transfer land, it's joint only in the name of men and women. You have accounts jointly in the name of men and women. So why is it such a problem if there are listing several owners as joint owners? So I think we'll probably be on the same page. I think you're sympathetic to the idea. Now, Dr. Madhusudan, in the Kerala case, they said we won't go into the SHG, we'll have a modification of the self-help group model. So they have neighborhood groups, because they said neighbors know each other and they're likely to get along much better if they form groups. Self-help groups are self-selected.
So homogeneity matters then.
No, they went for heterogeneity, because neighborhoods are less heterogeneous. Self-help groups are very homogeneous. Mm-hmm. So for instance, Telangana said we'll only have Dalit women in a group, and they had very little social capital to be able to lease in land. Kerala did much better, not heterogeneous in the sense of bringing in rich and poor, but heterogeneous in the sense that we'll go across community, across castes, across religions, and a little bit of above the poverty line and not just only below the poverty line. That helps a lot, because that brings in leadership, and it also increases your social capital if you want to lease in land. Mm-hmm. So for instance, if you're very poor, then you may not actually have much say and bargaining power. But if you are above the poverty line and you have across communities, then you are able to find people who are willing to lease the land. So it actually helps. And the neighborhood groups therefore become the saving and credit groups. And women who are members of the neighborhood groups can then go for group farming, or they can set up a shop, or they can go for marketing of other kinds. So you don't have to become a group farmer, but within that, they decide it's absolutely voluntary. I'll just, and then, because we're going to move to Dr. Dalwai, I just wanted to make a couple of comments, Dr. Dalwai.
Yeah.
One is that the farmer producers companies organizations are not producers, they are marketing organizations. So let's not call them producers, because production means you pool land and labor. Then you join together to produce together. And let's call them marketing organizations, because then there's a lot of misunderstanding. Maybe some of them may be pulling to produce together, but mostly they are not. I think they're important, but they're not the answer to the production problem. which I think needs to be separately taken. The second is women's issues are not social issues, they're economic issues because they're workers, and if 75% of women are based in rural India, and you know, 75% of rural workers in India are doing farming, and they form 30% of the agricultural workforce, then if they're seen as social and not producers, then it affects our national income. The third is, you're the National Rainfed Authority CEO. Let's hear a little more about what you're going to do on rainwater harvesting and other mechanisms, and also on the irrigation, a little more concretely, and the challenges that you face. Because once you tell us the challenges, then maybe some of us might have some say on possible solutions. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and Professor Bina has shared her comments. Let me join my own thoughts with that. I think let me first respond to the issue of land registration. I think all of us have failed this country. Let's all agree, particularly the officers from the, Madam, you'll agree, those of us who worked in administrative service, have really failed this country. Land is a basic thing. All other economic activities, including the people's living, all depend on land. Water is rooted on land. Everything is rooted on land. Now, many of the problems have been because we do not have clean land records. We must ensure that land management is cleaned up, digitalized, so that we're able to take up real-time changes that occur. Because land keeps on changing. Now, when you're talking about a land deed and a land mutation or title registration, a sale deed is quasi-judicial in nature. Anybody can sell anything. I can, for example, register the Parliament of Delhi in somebody else's name. You know, these things have happened, right?
Yeah, Eiffel Tower. I was just going to say, there's a story on man who sold the Eiffel Tower.
Yeah, exactly. So what is more important is that how do we ensure that the titles are actually reflected correctly? So what we need today, digitization of all the land records, as has happened at least in 8 states, and it should happen everywhere. The second one is to ensure that continuous and immediate land mutation happens. Where we are failing actually is in land mutations. Mutations take protracted time, and because of that, the real purchaser or real inheritor's name is not getting reflected. So we must, I think, clean up that mutation process and see how quickly and how in real time that mutation happens and the land title gets changed, not just on the record of rights, ROR, but also on the maps. So we should be able to use today proper spatial maps using the GIS, et cetera, and the geo-reference can be done for the land boundaries. Earlier it was all manual, you know.
But the jointness of co-partners.
Yeah, that also has to be done.
To be
And third one is, of course, to record jointly. All the land revenue acts of the states have been amended to jointly record the land in the name of the women, all the adult girls and women. But many states are actually not doing it in practice. So we must recognize that land ownership will come from the land records, and therefore that needs to be consistently, continuously mutated and reflected properly on the record of rights as well as on the maps. Okay, that is we all agree and we should do that stuff. Now, the second issue was relating to land pooling for agriculture. Certainly, Arvind, you're right. See, we need land leasing, right? Unfortunately, we are all set still in the old mindset. In the 1960s and 70s, when land reforms meant land to the tiller, it was good that we said the tiller owns the land, and therefore all the paraphernalia of regulations leading to that, that said that if you are in possession of a land and if you can prove that you're continuously cultivating that for 12 years, right, then you've got a right by adverse possession, right? But today, there is also land lease informally. People we know are leasing. In a state like Punjab, the oral lease is to the extent of 40%, right? And it is so in every state. Because we do not legally recognize that kind of a land lease, the actual cultivator, which we meant in the socialistic era of 1960s, 70s, Today, the actual cultivator is being deprived of the credit from the institutions. He's being deprived of the benefits that governments, both state subsidies. And center, or various subsidies we give. Imagine we spend 3 lakh crore on subsidies just on account of fertilizer, on account of procurement. And all these tillers who are lessees or sharecroppers are being deprived, and they're the poorest people. We therefore need to amend our state revenue acts and recognize these things. Law is the source of power. Why should any kind of a land leaser be scared once he's legally protected that he has been able to lease it out legally? I am wondering why the state governments are not adopting this model land lease act that Niti Aayog has shared in 2016.
Because the owners, as long as you have the idea that the owner will lose possession. If you prove as the possession, it's not going to move. That was the point I was making.
Precisely, that is the point. Our model land lease act precisely says that amend the state revenue act to legally provide for it. Yeah. Nothing is long. Now we have lost 3 years.
Already Madhya Pradesh done this thing.
No, I know. You have done it. All right. I'm sure you are one of the leaders. I've seen your act. Okay. But I'm saying that every state, the point was, I was trying to express a bit of anguish because today we need reforms in agriculture. All of us must recognize that since we rolled out liberalization in 91, we have done good in industry, we have done fairly good in financial sector, but not in agriculture. We believe as though agriculture is meant for the dud, meant for the uneducated, illiterate people. They are not entrepreneurs. They have been destined by God only to do that little bit of tillage. I think we all, particularly people, officers sitting from state governments, let's all recognize we need to bring liberalization. So Land Leasing Act. To answer Professor Bina, your issue that farmer producer companies are not producers is not true. No.
Maybe a few might be, but typically they are not.
No, I mean, we want that to happen. What has happened is a different story. What we are now talking about is we are also now promoting and we're going to set up what's called a national agriculture value system platform. A value system platform means integrates the farm gates with the final consumption center. The consumption center could be an industry, could be an export house, could be a bulk purchaser, could be a processor, could be within India or outside India. What we want to do now is that farmer producer companies or farmer producer societies, whatever name they go by, they shall take care of both technology extension services so that input management happens more efficiently and simultaneously output management also happens efficiently. The scales of economy must operate right from pre-sowing to the post-harvest management. That's what we are trying to do now. So the farmer producer companies, therefore what we have also now amended the Income Tax Act where up to a turnover of rupees 100 crore per annum, there's an exemption income tax because even a farmer producer company that generates profit will be considered as an agricultural profit. So we would like certainly not just post-harvest management, which is very important, no doubt, but also the pre-harvest management to become part of that. Yeah, it's a different model.
No, but it's not going to work.
No, let's see that.
One of the challenges that I have personally seen is the lack of flexibility in the kinds of arrangements that you get into. So, you know, for example, if you have the producer organizations, there is a tendency. I'm not saying that the rules don't allow it, but there's a tendency for one size fits all. Let me give you an example. I wish I owned 20 hectares of land, but I am actually a marginal farmer in the district of Barabanki in UP. One of the very interesting leasing models that started there about 6, 7, 8 years ago was by a farmer who started doing rotational crops. And then what he did was he started leasing land from people around him. When he started it, the lease was only on the basis of I will pay you X rupees per crop, per hectare. Very, very soon, those guys came back and said, well, if you are doing it, what do we do? So he started employing them and paying them something in addition to what they were getting for. Now, as they were there, now they were there 24 hours. What it has developed into is now they've got these, they don't call it panchayat, they call it something else. All of these guys sit together and discuss what is it that we are going to do. What is the experiences we have had this year? It seems as if the monsoon is not going to be good. Let's see if we can do maize.
They're doing crop planning jointly.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, what the point that I'm saying is that this evolved over time. It developed because people started getting confidence in each other's abilities. As a result, their comfort in land leasing has changed completely. Also, what has happened is that the incomes that they get are now at least, I mean, I have seen them growing 20%. I'm absolutely delighted for them and envious for myself. But the kinds of arrangements are also now much more complex. So this one says, okay, I'm leasing this much, but I'm keeping this much amount for growing vegetables for my own use. And then it says, okay, I know that Thakur Saab there wants vegetables, I'll grow vegetables for him. So there are all kinds of complex relationships that emerge. The point I want to put for discussion is, as when I started all of this, I was still in the government, and I was very uncomfortable with the changing nature of relationships, which were in a sense contractual relationships. I'm wondering how we catch it. This goes also to the issue which you raised of the title deeds. You know, there is a difference between the owner of a title and the beneficiaries of the usufruct. We are unable, in the legal system, we are unable to differentiate between them. The Forest Rights Act maybe provides some way in which we can start thinking about them. I don't have an answer. But we started this meeting to discuss land pooling in urban and rural areas. But my feeling is that we need to start a discussion on differentiating between ownership rights and between beneficial rights. Before I end this session, ma'am, I saw you pick up the microphone, so I'm going to ask you for a few for your comments. Then I've been warned that if I don't end the session, there will be no tea for anybody. So, ma'am, all yours.
I am Anita Chaudhary. I retired as secretary DOLR. Of course, I retired in 2012. And I wonder whether anybody from DOLR is here. I think joint secretary should have been here. Why I am saying this is because we are talking about land records. At the time when I was secretary, we had drafted a land titling act, right? It was a model act which was prepared. As you rightly said, anybody can sell any land to anybody. Even the registration that you do today is not a guarantee that you are the owner. Yeah. Anybody can come and question it. So Land Titling Act was drafted to ensure that the government is giving you a guarantee that you are the owner, so that nobody can come and this thing. But there are huge problems in enacting such an act. You are talking about upgradation of the land records. We keep talking about Karnataka case of Bhumi and, right? When you go deeper into that, yes, they have computerized the land records. But what is happening on the field and as far as the position is concerned is vastly different from what you get from any other way of measurement. Mm. We tried different types of measurements in different states. Gujarat did a manual measuring. Andhra Pradesh tried an aerial survey. Some states in Gujarat also tried satellite this thing. What we get from those, the demarcations are absolutely different from what exists on the ground. So even today, when we say that we will computerize and we will give you a record, it is not as per the actual facts on the ground. That is the main reason why the Land Titling Act is not seeing the light of the day. And it cannot see it. Unless we have a missionary mode, and in Haryana, they have done a lot of land consolidation. They have actually found those pillars which were drafted, which were made by the Britishers, and they have done the measurements, and actually the ground reality is as per the land records. But most of the states, this is not the fact. So this is the main problem as far as land records are concerned.
Okay. We need to end. A very short comment before I ask Preeti to
So I'll use this opportunity just to make very, just two small points. One is that the land records really need to have a gender component, that there has to be a column. Now, I talked to, after you, Dr. Gina, I went, had six meetings, and I think she sent a circular around to all the states that please have a column which says what is the gender of the owner. So I would request that again, since many of you are responsible here. The second is just want to reiterate Dr. Mathur's point to Dr. Dalwai as well, that you know one of the lessons that we've learned and globally on cooperation is please don't have rules made from the top, whether it's producer companies or anybody else, whether it's Elinor Ostrom's work, who won the Nobel Prize on this, or the work of many of us. If you go to the ground, you say, okay, you make the conditions to allow people to make their own rules. And producer companies are simply will create contracts with farmers. They are not an answer. Let farmers come together, enable them, saying, if you come together as a group, we're going to give you these privileges. But don't go in and say, these are the rules, and if you follow those rules, then you'll get those privileges. If you don't, you'll have the 1960s thing. Farmers will not succeed. At least that's what global experience says. So please, as government, let's learn that, that allow people to be innovative. And they will come up with quite complex and interesting solutions, but give them incentives to come together.
I won't join the issue with you. Yeah. I take your point that we need to have the people's participation, that people's views must be built into the rule. Just not views, their issues, okay? But we certainly also need an institutional mechanism to see that there are arbitrations, there are resolution mechanisms. In fact, our model contract farming act precisely gives that. It keeps it out of the court's jurisdiction, enables arbitration at gram panchayat level, at the subdivisional district level, so that the resolutions happen outside the court by the people themselves. We are aware. So I take the point that we must give flexibility to the people to organize themselves the way they want to. Yet we do require a framework so that there are mechanisms for dispute resolution. It's not that all people are equal. There are so many inequalities in our society. There's a big man who always tries to gobble up the smaller man. So keep all these things in mind. And but I do take your point. Thank you.
Well, you know, this is such an interesting discussion that I would have liked this session to go on. But Preeti, on one side, and on, I'm being forced to cut this. Yes, these women. Yeah, absolutely. So, may I now, I think Preeti does the vote of thanks?
Yes,
Preeti, can I request you to do the vote of thanks? Then we move out for tea and come back in 0 minutes? No, that's too long. 11:35.
Okay. I request Dr. Das to take the floor and... Dr. Das is the Commissioner of Income Tax on deputation to TERI, a senior fellow, works on the area of land, and I will ask her to give her the vote of thanks now.
She's the one who has made all of this happen.
Sir, first of all, I want to thank you for making villains of us. So, so respected Dr. Bina Agarwal, Dr. Ashok Dalwai, Dr. Mathur, the esteemed speakers, participants, and friends, it is my privilege to thank Dr. Bina Agarwal for the insightful address on the feasibility of adopting land pooling in the agricultural sector, which will enhance farm productivity, enhance incomes, and also empower the marginalized people. My deep sense of gratitude to Dr. Ashok Dalwai for his brilliant exposition of the utilization of the country's land resources. And in many ways, ladies and gentlemen, this workshop is a sequel to the National Conference on the 5-year journey of the Land Acquisition Act 2013 that we had organized last year in October. That time we had discussed different aspects of the act, and this time we will be hearing the state governments talk about their experience of the implementation of the RFCT-LARR Act 2013. And hopefully these discussions will result in suggestions that will enhance or improve the outcomes of the act. As land pooling has gained currency in recent years among policymakers and researchers, I think it is important for all stakeholders to come together and deliberate on the desired contours of an inclusive and sustainable land pooling policy. And I dare say that there cannot be a single land pooling policy. There are bound to be differences. We cannot have a single land pooling policy across different sectors and across geographical locations. There are bound to be differences in terms of the legislative framework, the institutional arrangements, the benefit sharing mechanism, the matrix, as well as the extent of people's participation in the design, planning, and execution. But I look forward to the fourth session of this workshop, where we will all confer on some on the various possibilities that we can come out with respect to each of these aspects of land pooling. And hopefully, we will also come out with some guiding principles, which to my mind is very important as we go forward in land pooling, which will take care of the interests of women, of the landless, the marginalized sections, of communities, and also of the environment. So I would extend a warm welcome to all the participants here. I hope you will find the proceedings of this workshop useful. And I sincerely hope that you will enjoy your time at Inda Habitat Center. Thank you. Sir, I would now like to request Dr. Mathur to please hand over a token of appreciation to Dr. Bina Agarwal and Dr. Ashok Dalwai.
Oh my God. This is produced at our feed station in the things to eat, or the cosmetics?
There are things to eat.
The things to eat. I hope they don't have sugar.
Some of them will.
Thank you very much.
But there's no sugar added.
Thank you.
Thank you.